only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I sing for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I sing for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I sing for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. 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 I can only imagine.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Dave. Appreciate that. Thank you so much. Let's open our Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter number 21. The Gospel of John, chapter number 21, and we'll be reading a passage that I know you're very familiar with. Probably been a number of sermons in many places you might have heard concerning this passage. We're going to do a little different approach to it today. And as we read in John 21 verses 15 through 17, you see there it says, "So when they had dined, Jesus saith unto Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He said unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest I love thee. And he saith unto him, Feed my lambs. He saith again to him again in the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. He said unto, saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, feed my sheep. Now, years ago, when I was a Ute director, we called them Utes back then. We'd go on these trips or we'd go on a activity and the young people would always get on the bus or the van, whatever, and they'd come out with this song. They'd say, Brother Cooley, do you love Jesus? And I was supposed to answer, yes, I love Jesus. And then they'd sing back, tell me why you love Jesus. Or are you sure you love Jesus? And I'd say, yes, I'm sure I love Jesus. Now, they did this because they wanted me to sing, and I knew I massacred songs, and the voice was horrible. But they'd force me into this, you know. Are you sure you love Jesus? Then they'd say, well, tell me why you love Jesus. And I was supposed to answer, and I did. This is why I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. And then we'd all break out into, oh, how I love Jesus. Hey, those were the simplistic times of life, were they not? But as you think about that song and this passage today, I think it wouldn't hurt to hear a testimony of why I love Jesus. I think you can concur with what I say. If you know the Lord Jesus today, you can say, this is why I love Jesus. And we're going to go over a couple of things today, but we all have a personal sermon, if you would, to tell why we love Jesus. Back in the 1930s, there was a famous doctor from Austria named Dr. Lorenz, and he pioneered some orthopedic surgery that up to that point had not been done. In fact, he was able to do it without surgical tools. They called him the bloodless doctor, very famous worldwide. Came to America, and there was a multimillionaire little daughter who had not been able to walk because she had a deformity of the hip bone and had left her incapacitated. And so they called in Dr. Lorenz, and he came to Chicago to do this particular surgery. And it was very successful. In equivalent today's time, it would cost about $250,000 in today's money. At that time, of course, it didn't, but it was very expensive and out of the reach for most people. Well, the newspaper there, the Chicago Sun-Times, they put that thing out on front page news, and there was another little boy there on the south side of Chicago, very poor. They scraped by just to eat. He saw the newspaper, the headline, and he read it with great interest. He was incapacitated with the same problem. And so as he read the newspaper, looked at his mother and he said, Mama, he said, wouldn't it be great if the doctor could make me walk like he made that little girl walk? Well, when the poor mother heard it, knowing their condition of poverty, she ran out of the room just weeping and crying, knowing there was no way that they could pay the money for this child to be healed. And so while she was in her room crying and weeping and praying, it's like God spoke to her heart and God told her, go down to the motel where this man is at and knock on his door and ask him to do the surgery. And so she said, I did it. I felt absolutely great anxiety about it, but I just felt like that's what God wanted me to do. So she made her way down and she knocked on the door. He thought she was the cleaning staff. And when he opened the door, she fell down on her knees and began to tell him her story of her little boy. And she cried out. And he said, ma'am, do you have any money? And she, weeping and crying, said, no, sir, I don't have any money at all. He said, well, I'm going to tell you something, what I'm going to do. He says, I'm going to do your boy's surgery for free. She was overwhelmed and began to kiss his hands and even reached down to kiss his feet. That doctor restrained her, Dr. Lorenz did. And so the doctor went ahead and took the boy to the hospital, and and the operation was performed, and the boy was kept in the hospital, I think, about 12 weeks. And then one day, the mother came in, and was, as she did every day, to visit and stay with the boy. And the little boy told his mother, said, "Mama, I want you to go to the window and look out. I want you to look out." And she goes, "Look at what?" He said, "Don't you worry about it. Just look out and see what you could see." And she reluctantly went over to the window, began to look out that high-rise window. And about 20 seconds while she was looking, she felt a tug on her little coat there. And she turned around, and that was her son, who got up out of bed, and he had been, of course, going to therapy, and he walked over to her. Of course, they embraced with great glee, and it wasn't long after that the doctor came in the room. And the doctor came in, and the young boy ran over to grab the doctor and hugged him. And he grabbed the doctor's hands and began to kiss the doctor's hands. And the doctor said, "Oh, stop, stop. I don't want you to do that." And that little boy, I think he was about 13, he said, "Doctor, as long as there's a tongue in my mouth, ain't nobody going to be able to stop me from telling what you did for me." Now, folks, he went that way. We ought to be able to tell what Jesus did for us. I mean, man, he did a whole lot more than make us walk. He saved our souls. He took care of us. And so I love the Lord Jesus, as you do, because what he's done for us. I mean, let's face it. He loved me and you while we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. There's no doubt about it. I mean, think of it. Say there's a king, and he has many subjects, and if some of those subjects came out against him and began to rebel against him. In fact, they organized a coup to try to depose him, and he found out about it and all of that, and they hated his laws. They wouldn't do what he says, but yet, in spite of all this, the king said, "I'm going to still love him and take him under my wing and take care of him." Wow, we thought, what kind of king would do that? But I'll tell you the truth, the Lord Jesus, our king, did even more, because we were without strength and without God. We were enemies of the cross of Christ. We were without hope. We were dead in trespasses and sin. And with all that, he commended his love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Hey, you ought to love him for that. I mean, there was nothing lovely about us. In fact, just quite the contrary. We were unlovely and ungodly. So today, can't be said enough what he did. I know what he did for me while I was a sinner. Hey, there were times I wouldn't even think of him. Wouldn't consider the claim of God on my life. Wouldn't even talk about it. Didn't want to even enter in my thought any concept of God or the Bible. Turned off and turned away. And yet he showed me his love despite all that. I can go back to my hometown to this day, and folks are still shaking their head. You say, "How's that possible?" I'm telling you, they're going, "We still don't understand what happened to him. He just never got over it, you know." And so I have to say, as many of you, I love him in the fact that he loved me while I was a sinner. And he paid the price for our sin. I mean, hey, loving us is one thing, but paying our sin price is another. A preacher went to, evangelist was preaching in a church, went to visit in the pastor's home as normal. And the visiting preacher was talking with a son and daughter, and he said, "Hey, they're really great kids," and all of that. And he kind of got where he felt a real affection for them, a love for them. And in the midst of the meeting, the boy one day went outside, and he found a cigarette butt. And he picked up that cigarette butt, took it to his bedroom, and while that visiting preacher was in the home, he lit that thing up. And of course, smoke filled the room, and smoke began to fill the house. In fact, the mother was in the kitchen, and she smelled cigarette smoke. She ran into where it came from and ran into the room, and there that boy was over there in the corner with his back turned to the door, smoking away. Why, she caught him in the act, of course, and lambasted him and said, "You know, when your daddy comes home, I'm going to tell him what you've done." Well, Dad did get home before the meeting that night, and Mother explained to him that what had happened, and the dad didn't have time to deal with it. They had to go to the revival meeting, and so he said to the son, he says, "When I get home, I'm going to discipline you for that." Well, they went to church that night. The boy heard the message of God and realized that God was putting a call on his life, and went down to the altar and had a testimony that he believed God was calling him into the ministry. And everybody rejoiced, and the boy got right with God and asked for forgiveness and all that. And so after the meeting, the evangelist talked to the pastor. He said, "Isn't that great what happened to your boy tonight?" He said, "Oh, yeah, that's fantastic. He said, "You're not going to discipline him now after all of that, are you?" And the dad said, "Yes, sir." He said, "I told him what I was going to do, and I'm going to do it." You know, that evangelist that night wrote this down. He says, "I thought about it, and I thank God even the more that the Lord Jesus, after I got right with God, he will not discipline me at all. He forgave me, and he cleansed me. Even though I had violated his law, even though I had done him wrong, even though I had not fulfilled what I ought to, God didn't discipline that preacher." He said, "I've sinned many times." And he says, "I go to the Lord and ask forgiveness." He says, "Okay, I forgive you. Well, we reach that with the Lord Jesus. He paid our price for sin. For our past sin, he paid for it. For our present sin, he paid for it. And for our future sin, he paid for it. And the scripture says, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. Now, folks I don't know why people don't want to accept that. I mean, it's one of the greatest things could happen to you. It's why we love Jesus. We literally experience what it means to be forgiven and cleansed. You know, people don't forgive each other. People will move on, but they don't forgive. And many times it's just assumed offense. Sometimes it's not even offense, but people get upset at other people when they think about something. I was talking to a lady yesterday here that was at the funeral, and she's in her 80s, and she was telling me, she says, "I don't do Facebook." A conversation came up, said, "Have you seen my son lately?" And I said, "No, I don't. Did you know he moved out here in this place?" I said, "I didn't know that." I said, "I don't do Facebook. I don't know what happens in this world." She goes, "I don't do it either." She says, "I don't want to know what happens." I said, "Hey, sister, me and you are on the same page. I don't know about all the offenses and the non-offenses and the innuendos. And I'll tell you what I do hear about it. People are mean to each other. Oh, my goodness. Why? Hey, people use these social media things to be such a way they wouldn't dare be that way face to face. It would make them look as bad as it does when they do it on these social media places. They just don't think folks form an opinion. I'm telling you, this anger towards each other is incredible. And this lack of forgiving. Think why you love Jesus. He forgave you despite who you were. He forgives you for all your offenses. He forgives you for your times that you discredit him, maybe not willingly, but simply by the way you live your life and walk through your testimony. He says, "Listen, you failed me, you've got faults, but I still love you. I still love you." Hey, I love him because of that. I love the Lord Jesus, and I know you do too, because he sent the Holy Spirit to convict us and point me to Christ. I mean, I didn't come in church one day and Jesus meet me at the back door physically and touch my shoulder and say, "Listen, I'm glad you're here and I want you to trust me." He's not present in bodily form here on this earth right now. He told them, and the angel did as he ascended back to heaven, and says, don't you gaze up in the sky, because this same Jesus whom you've seen go up in this manner, this same one whom you've seen shall one day so come in like manner. And we'll physically see him again. But he did not leave us without a representative, the Holy Spirit of God. And while I walked in church and went to services, the Holy Spirit literally came by my side and began to convict me of my sin and my unbelief and my rejection. He was ever present there. Every time the Word of God was preached, he began to make me sense my guilt and understand my lost condition. And everybody that saved here today, whether you were a child that got saved or whether you were an adult that got saved, you know the only way it happened was the Holy Spirit of God draw you to the Savior. Made you sense who you were, made you sense your condition, lost without hope, and made you understand that Christ died in your place and offers you eternal life. It can't help but say, this is why I love Jesus. He sent the Holy Spirit to convict us. There's other things what he's done for us in the past. The songwriter kind of summarized it when he said this, wounded for me, wounded for me. There on the cross he was wounded for me. Gone my transgressions, and now I am free. All because Jesus was wounded for me. I'm telling you today, he died for us. And he sent the Spirit of God to convict us. And he gives us eternal life. Hey, he saved us and he wrote our names in the Lamb Book of Life. I mean, God knows who we are by name. I mean, you got to love him for that. He's got billions of people to deal with. He not only knows your name, if you're saved, your name's in the registry of heaven. I go to a place in the fall sometimes called Sugar Bush Farms. It's a place where they have maple syrup and cheeses and all that stuff. You know, it's out in the Woodstock, Vermont, out in the mountain area. And when you go in there, they want you to sign the book. Why, you walk up there and you look and there's books and books of pages and pages of people that have signed their name. And it tells you, where are you from? And you can look down there and see them. They're from all over the world that come there. And so, of course, I go by and sign my name every time. You know what it means? Nothing. It means my name is mixed up with probably 50,000 people. My name being written in the Sugar Bush Farm book has absolutely no significance whatsoever. I guarantee you, nobody will ever flip through there and look for the name of Mark Cooley. They could care less, and if they did find it, they wouldn't know who it was. But not so when your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. He puts it in there when you get saved. It gives you eternal life, and I'm telling you, it's written in permanent ink. And I guarantee you, when you get to heaven, they're not going to say, who is this, number what? No, they're going to call you by name, and they're going to know who you are, because the Lord Jesus did that for us. Hey, we love him because of what he's done for us in the past and the fact that he saved us and wrote our name in the Lamb's Book of Life. You can't help but echo that song, oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. I also thank the Lord for the fact when he saved me, for me, I thank him that he called me to preach. Now, as I look back in my life, I believe from the moment I was born, he began to create me for that work. I hate to tell you, but I was the kid in elementary school that got the leading role of every school play. No, I'm not bragging. I didn't want to do it, but they knew I had the gift of gab. And I still remember in the second grade, they put me in a sport coat. Put me some big old black frame glasses on me. Put a tie on me. I was a second grade man. And I was the professor of that play. And I was the guy that narrated the whole story. And of course, as it went on, you know, you ended up, and once I got saved, the first time I went to church when I got saved as a 21-year-old, I went in there and the guy said, "Here," and he handed me some of those big old cardboard songs. And get up there and lead the music. First Sunday I was saved in children's church, they said, "We need some help in here." I'm going, "Well, I'd like to go down there and make a profession of faith." "Hey, you can do that tonight." So that's what the guy said. So I get up there with these songs. I've never heard most of them. I've been out of church for quite some time. And so I get these things out, and I told the story before, but I got to that one, "Why worry when you can pray? Trust Jesus, he'll show you the way." It had those flip cards, you know, and "Why worry when you trust Jesus, he'll show you the way." Kids out there singing. And I got mixed up, and literally I was going, "Why pray when you can worry?" Hey, but it didn't matter. They put me up there the next week. Then they started telling me to read. And then about 3 weeks later, he said, "I want you to bring the message today in children's church." Whoa, wait a minute. I don't want to do that. I can't do that. Yeah, you can. Hey, but I knew from the beginning that God was calling me to preach. I had no doubt about it. And I thank him for it. And I actually love him for it. I mean, there's been a lot of ups and downs, but I'm going to tell you something. God has been good. And I appreciate everything he's done for me. In fact, I will, the Lord willing, serve him until he takes me home, one way or the other. You know, I used to kid folks here. Said, "Well, when are you going to quit the ministry? When are you going to retire?" I said, well, I'll be up here preaching. And the Lord will take me home. I'll fall right over on the communion table. You already got flowers there. Don't need any flowers. And then y'all have the little service there. And then go on back to the fellowship hall and eat your fried chicken and macaroni and cheese. Have a big time. And if I don't have some cemetery lot board bought somewhere, just carry me out there on the ball field around second base. Dig a hole and plant me out there. I don't know. As far as I'm concerned, what do you do if you're not serving the Lord? I mean, in some capacity. I may not be pastoring, but I'll be witnessing, and I'll be teaching, and I'll be filling in where I can. It doesn't matter if you're called, and those of you who know this, you know it's your life. One way or the other, it's your life. You may end up doing something else, but it never changes your life for who you are. I thank God for that. I really do. In fact, there was this fellow who was living with his widow mother, and he had been taking care of her there in upstate New York for many years since his father had passed away, and she had become very dependent on his care. And then one day he got a brand new job offer he couldn't turn down. It was in Boston. And she was brokenhearted that he was going to leave, but she knew it was good for him. And so she said, "Son, there's a art store downtown. I want you to go with me tomorrow morning." And he said, "Mom, I ain't got time for that. I got to get everything ready and packed. I'll be leaving." She goes, "Son, I know you're leaving soon, but I want you to do this one thing for me. I want you to go to that art store. There's a picture I want to show you." He reluctantly agreed, and he went down there with her. And they went into this dark room with a little light in the back of the room. And he saw a picture. It was a picture of a man kneeling to pray. And he looked at it, and he was moved by that picture. The man had great sadness on him, and his hands were lifted up. That night he went out to party, but he couldn't party on his last night in town. He just was so moved by that painting. And so he went home, and God began to deal with him. And the next day, his mother woke him up and said, "Son, I want you to go one more time down to that painting." And he said, "Mama, I kind of want to go too." They went back the second day, and they went into the room, and he said, "Mama," he said, "who is this man?" And she goes, "Son, that's Jesus." He's in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he's praying for those he's about to die for. It so touched his heart that he trusted Christ right on the spot. And he said this. He said, Jesus, blessed Lord, if there's anything left undone that I can do for you, you can count on me. Listen, every Christian in this room today ought to have the same love for the Lord Jesus. Whatever it is God allows you or wants you to do for Him, you ought to be wanting to do it also because of the fact that He has already shown His great love towards you. He's loved us in the past. He saved us. He's called us. In fact, every Christian here today is called to be an ambassador for Christ. You may not be called to preach. You may not be given a gift to teach, but you can be a representative in some form or fashion. We have people yesterday that come and help serve the sorrowing and the grieving. Hey, that's a calling of God on your life. There are others who prepare the buildings and make sure it's right. That's calling. There are folks who give. That's a calling of God. There are folks who pray constantly and pass out tracts and witness to the people at work. That's a calling of God. I thank God and I love Jesus because He called me. I know you do also. And then I love Him for what He's doing right now. I already love Him for what He's done in the past. You can't help but. But He's doing a lot right now. He daily forgives our sins. He says if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I mean, we can sing nothing between my soul and the Savior. David, the man of God. In fact, the Bible said he's a man after God's own heart. Why, he is the one that wrote, the Lord is my shepherd. He also wrote, God is my refuge. But sadly, as we know, he fell into a great sin. And he broke his fellowship with God. But you know, it didn't last permanently. In fact, in Psalm chapter 32, a great psalm, he literally laid it out. Turn with me, if you would, as we get towards our closing. Psalms 32, and see what David said about what the Lord did for him after he got right with God over that sin. Psalms 32, 1, David said, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. He said, blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. Then he began to proclaim how bad he got when he got out of fellowship with God. He was a man after God's own heart, but he had gotten away from the close relationship of fellowship that he so enjoyed in the midst of his day. He said, I was miserable. And then in verse 5, he says, I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and my iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. Hey, I love the Lord Jesus because he does the same for me and for you daily. You're saved, thank God. You're not perfect. You're saved, you're not without faults. I mean, think of this. If somebody hurts or discourages or picks on your kid, you look at that person and you can, the one that's doing the persecution, you can see every flaw in that person. You look at them and say, yeah, look, they probably got it from their mama and daddy and they probably was raised this way and blah, blah. But you don't ever consider the flaw of your child. You just can't do it. And it ought to be that way. You look past them. Well, the Lord Jesus looks at us who disobey him and sees us with many flaws. But you know, he still loves us. I mean, whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. But it doesn't take away the fact he sees every flaw and still forgives us. What a great God we serve. It's totally more than most of us can deal with. He's helping us to live day by day. He strengthens us and takes care of us. A little girl was walking with her father down a busy street, and he said, "Honey, we're fixed to cross the street." Said, "Well, here, grab my hand." Of course, she was in that grown-up mode now. "No, I don't need to hold your hand. I can make it myself." Well, they stepped out towards the curb, and as she got out there, big 18-wheeler, whoa, went by. City bus, whoa, went by. Cars were going to and fro, speeding, and she got fearful, and she looked up and said, "Daddy, I think I will take your hand." Listen, hey, we treat the Lord a lot. He helps us to live every day. Every day he takes care of us and helps us to live, but sometimes we say we don't need him. And yet, when we face a crisis, that's the first one we turn to. We take his hand. He's always willing to help and lead us and guide us. Hey, I thank him for what he's done in the past. I thank him for what he's done now. But you know what? I think I say the best for last. I thank him and I love him for what he's going to do for us. You know what he's going to do? One day he's going to come and get us. Now, he said, at this point, he said that I go to prepare a place for you, and when I go, I'll come back and receive you unto myself. I'm going to come get you. Now, he may come in death. The Bible tells us even then, absent from the body, it's present with the Lord. He's going to come. I love him because I'm not going to be left alone. I won't be forgotten. He's going to be right there, and himself welcome me into my heavenly home. And if not then, he's going to come one day in the moment, in a twinkling of an eye. The Bible says that the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be cut up together in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And if that's not the case, he's going to one day blow the trumpet. And the rest of us that are not dead in Christ, our bodies will be buried, but they'll be reunited where our soul and spirit will be changed. But there'll be some alive here on this earth never experienced death. And you know what? For them, it's going to be equally true. He's just going to say, "Come up hither." Can you imagine what the heathen are going to say when all of a sudden everybody disappears? A lot of people. I heard somebody the other day say, "I know what they're going to say. They're going to say the aliens have finally come and shuttle them away on giant spaceships." Those heathen, they'll say that knowing what they heard the Word of God say. They don't care. But one day they will care. God will judge the world in sin. Well, I love him for all that. He answers prayers, does he not? He keeps us at his side forever. And he will reunite us one day with our loved ones. I thought about the other day we've had, and I mentioned, but some of the folks that were real influential in my life since I've been here. One of the men was Reuben Dyer. I mean, Reuben was he walked up here. He moved from Pennsylvania. He was a retired railroad man. Him and his wife moved down here, Mon. And he wasn't here but a week, and he says, "Back in my home church," he said, "I did all the maintenance on the church." He said, "If you'd like for me to do that, give me some keys." I reached in my pocket. I had about 40 keys on a ring that I've been carrying around. I dumped them on him that moment. I said, "Here you go, bud. Have at it." And for 9 years, that man single-handedly did all the things. He built walls. He tore walls down. He remodeled rooms. I mean, he did stuff that he knew how to do everything. And then one day he was doing the fellowship hall, putting down vinyl baseboards, and he got to feeling bad. He said, "Preacher, I'm going home and rest." And he said, "I'll be back tonight," which was Wednesday night. He came back Wednesday night. He was still dizzy. He actually took me out into the shed that day and said, "Preacher, I put this material here. I put these instructions here. If you ever need to know how to operate that blower and that lawnmower, all the stuff's right here in case you don't know." I said, okay, Reuben. The next morning, I got a call from his wife. He'd had a major stroke. And they rushed him to the hospital. He couldn't talk. And I got real close to him. And he always said to us, he said, "I just don't want to die with a stroke." He said, "I don't want to be like my brother." Reuben was 70 years old. Young 70. And he lasted one day and he died. I had my hand on his heart when it took the last beat. Hey, one day, God will reunite us with our loved ones. I love him for that. I mean, you could go on and on. I think about Frank Middlebrooks. Frank was a great supporter. Not always an agreeer, but a great supporter. He always had my back. Even though when he didn't like what my back was, he was that kind of guy. And Frank passed on so quickly. He was always faithful. Eddie Evans, Pearl White. I look forward to seeing Brother Roy Julian. For years, we pastored side by side. I used to kid Roy and said, Roy, go raise your American flag. We're having VBS. We're going to bring our kids out in the parking lot, and we're going to say Pledge Allegiance to your flag. But Roy and I had this thing going. Roy would send all the people that came to ask for money. He'd say, listen, we don't have any, but go around there to Brother Cooley's church. He helps folks with money. And they'd come up here and say, the preacher over there at Smyrna said, you give us money. And I'd say, what? And so I'd go send mine. When they come up here, I'd say, no, I'm sorry, we don't have any right now, but go to Smyrna, they'll take care of it. So one day I saw Roy walking down the street, and I said, Roy, if you send one more guy to my church, I'm going to take out a phone book ad next year in the yellow pages said, Smyrna, we help transients with money. And I miss him. Wasn't real close with him, but that kind of camaraderie was good. Hey, I thank God one day that Jesus will reunite us with our loved ones and friends. Oh, how I love Jesus for what he's done in the past, what he does in the present, and what he's going to do in the future. I hope you can say the same thing. Let's bow our heads together if you would. If you're here today, you've never met Christ as your Savior, listen. He loves you. He's already showed the ultimate gift of sacrifice for you. He gave his life for you. But you've got to trust him. You can't just talk about it. You have to, with your heart, wholly depend on him for your soul salvation. You can do that today by simply saying, Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I'm without hope. But Jesus, you died for me, shed your blood, and I accept that sacrifice as the way of my salvation today. You can do that. If you will do that, I'll ask you to come meet me here at the front. Let us know about it. We'll take the word of God and have prayer with you. Christian friend, you may be here and you need to just say, hey, I've not told the Lord I've loved him very long. I don't even mention it to him. I just ask him for things. Maybe you need to spend some time saying, I love you, Lord Jesus. I love you. Lord, we pray you'd bless the opportunity here today. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.